United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Councilwoman Karamba.
Present.
Councilman DeWitt.
Here.
Councilman Slakta.
Here.
Mayor Simmons.
Here.
Councilman O'Flynn.
Here.
Councilman Gibson.
Here.
Councilman Forbes.
Here.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Mayor.
Sorry. Audrey, you want to get us kicked off?
Absolutely. I'm going to read the title block of the case in the record. Now, I have not reviewed the affidavit of publication. Is it on file with your office? We'll check. Okay, yes, it is. This is a zoning ordinance of the city of Bonita. I know why, because we continued the case.
Yes.
A zoning ordinance of the city of Bonita Springs, Florida, considering a request to amend Bonita Springs zoning ordinance number 05-17, condition 2B, to reduce the front street and rear setbacks on lots 10 and 11 and 16, 17, amending the maximum lot coverage for lots 10, 11, and 17, located at 26890, 26891, 26900, 26901, Red Blossom Court, Bonita Springs, Florida, providing for an effective date. This is second reading of the ordinance. The ordinance was continued, at which time there was an affidavit of publication at City Council's March 13th meeting. This particular case went to the Zoning Board on February 14th, who recommended denial, and staff, who recommended approval. At this time, the applicant will proceed forward with the case, and I will swear in the witnesses prior. So if I could have everybody who will be testifying on this particular case raise their right hand. Okay, and do you swear or affirm testimony provided today from the truth, whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Thank you. Now, we have some people here who have been tendered as experts in the past, and there may be some people in this audience that I don't know who may also be experts. So I'm going to go with the people first who I know are experts. The first is Dan DeLisi, along with Mike Fegan, and both have been tendered as experts in land use and planning. Same with Mr. Dolmer and Ms. Jensen. John Dolmer and Jacqueline Jensen, they've been previously tendered as experts in land use and planning. Mr. DeLisi, do you have any other experts here?
No.
Okay.
John Daly, who is the construction manager for Habitat for Humanity.
Okay. And do you want to step up here so I can just have you voidered? Okay. So we're going to ask you some questions. First of all, for the record, please state your full name.
John Daly.
And put the microphone a little closer. You're a tall person. Thank you. Can you inform City Council what you do for a living?
I'm the Vice President of Construction at Habitat for Humanity. I'm a licensed GC in the state of Florida.
Okay. A licensed GC? And
General
what
Contractor.
That stand for?
General Contractor.
Have you been previously tendered as an expert in general contracting in the past?
I have.
Okay. Can you tell us which tribunals?
I was in the testified several times in the Miami area. That would be Dade County.
Okay. And was those type of hearings similar to this type of hearing here today?
It was not a zoning board, but it was construction-related issues.
Okay. And I presume your testimony today will be on construction issues?
Construction land use issues, yes.
Okay. And you, at that time when you testified, you were testifying as a GC, general contractor?
As a developer / general contractor, yes.
Okay. Ms. Montgomery, do you have any questions that you would like to ask of him?
No, I would just admit that he has experience and education greater than the general public and was therefore qualified as an expert and asked that he be so accepted.
And I believe he can, unless there's any objections or if council would like to ask any additional questions.
Council?
No, sir.
No? Okay.
Consider yourself so tendered.
Thank you.
We have John Daly, we met Kitty Green, and what I could do you have the microphone? We can either have the people put their name in the record now or when they're actually testifying. Council's call, probably when they testify.
I would think that'd probably be better.
That's, okay, yep. At that time, Mr. DeLisi, would you provide us with your case, or Ms. Green?
I'm not quite as tall as John, almost. Good morning.
Morning.
I hope you all had a nice Easter, and thank you for being here bright and early this morning to hear this case. My name is Kitty Green, and I'm President and CEO of Habitat for Humanity. I'll be handling the first part of this presentation this morning, and Dan DeLisi will handle the technical issues in the second part of the presentation. John and others are here just for questions if you have technical questions, okay? So let me see, get my clicker. Habitat for Humanity operates in 70 countries and 1,300 communities in the United States. We all operate independently with our own board of directors and our own funding, but we are united around a single vision and mission. Our vision is a world where everyone has a decent place to live, and our mission is to bring people together to build homes, communities, and hope. Our local affiliate builds and rehabs existing homes in many different communities throughout Lee County and Hendry County. Since we started here 35 years ago, we have put more than 1,400 families in Lee and Hendry counties into their very own homes. 75 of those families are here in the city of Bonita Springs. I will tell you that Bonita Springs is our favorite place to work, and that is primarily because you have such professional and helpful staff. So, congratulations for that. Studies show that safe, decent, and affordable housing is foundational to a family's ability to lift itself up. Decent housing is closely linked to improved health outcomes and improved educational outcomes. In fact, children who have grown up in a home that their families own are 116% more likely to graduate college. Unfortunately, affordable housing is very hard to come by in Bonita Springs and Lee County in general due to a combination of low wages and lack of availability of low-cost housing. The United Way did a study that shows that 39% of all jobs in Florida fall below what is considered the minimum survival wage of $13.71 per hour. The people who serve us in our stores and our restaurants, who mow our lawns, who take care of our elderly, they are struggling to survive, much less get ahead. Right here in our county, one out of every four children are living in poverty. The average low-income family in the Fort Myers, Cape Coral MSA pays 44% of their income for housing, plus another 30% of their income for transportation. That leaves 26% for everything else. Habitat believes that every family deserves the opportunity for a better future, and we work to help them build strength, stability, and self-reliance through shelter. But the need is tremendous. Last year, we sold 50 homes to families in Lee and Hendry counties, but we received 674 applications. That's almost 14 applications for every house we had the funds to build. We need your support for this zoning amendment, because we need to help more families in Bonita have an affordable home. Affordable housing sometimes has a negative connotation, so I want to be clear about Habitat's program. We help families who make less than 80% of the area median income, who are legal residents, who pass a background check, and who have a great need but are willing to help themselves. We teach them about the responsibilities of homeownership, including home maintenance. If they live in a subdivision, they learn about what a homeowners association is. And yes, Red Hibiscus is deed restricted and has a homeowners association with a professional manager. Prospective homeowners take at least 16 hours of classes and put in at least 300 hours of sweat equity to help build their house or someone else's. In building those homes, they work alongside and get to know volunteers of all ages and income groups. I'm thankful that in Bonita, we enjoy tremendous volunteer support, primarily from support groups in Bonita Bay, Pelican Landing, and Shadowwood. We have approximately 300 volunteers in Bonita Springs and nearly 700 individuals and organizations who provide financial support through our Restore or contributions. Most importantly, I want to reiterate, we do not give homes away. Our homeowners buy their homes from us with an affordable mortgage, which helps them build equity in an asset and helps put money back in the program for the next homeowners. Habitat's model has been successful both locally and nationally. Requiring homeowners to invest in their homes ensures that they value them, care for them, and keep them. We have less than a 1% foreclosure rate annually. Since 2001, Habitat homeowners in Lee and Hendry counties have paid almost $6 million in property taxes. The Red Hibiscus subdivision was permitted and developed by the Bonita Springs Area Housing Development Corporation, which deed restricted it for affordable housing and then went out of business before any homes were built. The lender foreclosed on the subdivision, and with the support of the city and Lee County, Habitat was eventually able to buy the subdivision from the lender. We were very excited about this acquisition because, as I have described, the need in Bonita Springs is huge, and land for building in Bonita Springs is very expensive. Having a 26-lot developed subdivision in a great location just off East Terry Street and across from the soccer park was ideal. The surrounding uses are multifamily homes and a dog kennel, so we felt confident that our small single-family homes would be compatible. Because it's a little confusing, I want to clarify with you that the name of the platted subdivision is Red Hibiscus, which is also the name of the street from which the subdivision is accessed, and which also accesses other homes. The private street within Red Hibiscus subdivision is called Red Blossom Court. The house that we build in Red Hibiscus is 3 or 4 bedrooms with 2 bathrooms and 1,859 square feet under roof. Currently, there are 14 homes completed and sold in Red Hibiscus, with 5 homes currently under construction. That leaves 7 lots at the cul-de-sac end of the subdivision, which we plan to begin building this fall. That is why this zoning amendment is before you. The home that fits on all of the previous lots will not fit on 4 of the cul-de-sac lots. Designing a new home for 4 lots is expensive, and the homes would either be exceptionally small or 2-story, which is not volunteer-friendly and therefore also expensive. Modifying the setbacks will avoid that and will not adversely impact the subdivision or the neighboring properties. Now, Dan DeLisi will address the specifics of exactly what we are asking. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Morning, Dan.
Good morning. For the record, Dan DeLisi, wrong direction. All right, as Kitty mentioned, we're in a location where we have surrounding uses that are fairly unique. We're not in a single family subdivision. We have multifamily to the south of the property. We have multifamily to the north. We have a BSU lift station to our east, and we have a dog kennel to our west. It is a pretty unique situation where we're at in terms of how these setbacks will impact surrounding uses. Let me go over the site plan and walk you through what exactly is being proposed. As the staff report points out, we're asking for setbacks, rear yard setbacks for, well, let me just point out the picture on the left is the existing Red Blossom Court subdivision. You could see homes that are already constructed, and the 4 units that we're talking about are the ones where the footprints are designed in black. Underneath to the south of the units that are already constructed. A couple things to point out about this subdivision, you could see the lots just to the north of the 4 that we're talking about.
I'm sorry, Dan, so the black, or the 2 on one side and 2 on the other below,
yes,
the houses?
Sorry, let me use the...
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Sure. These are the 4 that we're talking about.
Right.
Just to the north, you could see as we enter the cul-de-sac, these units, as Kitty talked about, same size units as every other unit in the subdivision. As you get the curve in the road, you have to set them back. So that's what we're faced with. Of course, when you do that, the rear lot lines are constant, and so you start running into an issue with how the setback, how close you are to the property line setback. The other thing I want you to notice about this is that we're not talking about a setback from the PUD, from the planned development boundary. We're talking about a setback from the lot line. So these red lines are the lot line. The black line, which is outside of that, is the planned development line. So on the east side, you have a 40-foot drainage easement, and on the left side, you have a 12-foot drainage easement. So we're not talking about a 5-foot setback from property to property, adjacent property to adjacent property. We're talking about 5 feet plus drainage easement, then you get to the next property. And on the west, again, that's a dog kennel, and on the east, that's a BSU lift station. On the front, we're requesting a front setback, a lesser front setback of 10 feet here. The other thing I want you to notice about the site plan is you have a 10-foot drainage swale around the entire cul-de-sac road. That is not atypical, but you have approved a number of developments in the past without roads like that. So, for instance, last month I was before you all, and we approved a subdivision where the drainage was not on the outside of the road, it was on the inside of the road. And because of that, the lot line actually came up to the edge of pavement. In this case, the lot line doesn't come up to the edge of pavement. So some of the concerns that we've heard about how can you get cars stacked in the driveway, you have an additional 10 feet outside of the lot that is still the paved driveway before you get to the edge of pavement. And if any of you have lived in a subdivision like that, as I have, that is your driveway. People don't know, unless they just move in and they see the survey stakes on where the lot line is, there's no way to tell that your lot line comes up 10 feet back from the edge of pavement. You consider and you maintain up to the edge of pavement. And that's the way cars are parked, and that's the way subdivisions look. And you could see that over here on the picture on the bottom. You see the swale, the culvert, and the driveway goes all the way to the edge of pavement. The mailbox is right here at the edge of pavement. It's not within the property line, and there's extra space to park cars. When we talk about compatibility, again, let's take a look at what's going on here. These are pictures on the east side, and you could see the distance between the back of the homes to the drainage swale to the property line, which again would be the BSU lift station. And I don't think, and I have not heard, that there's a compatibility concern on the east side. On the west side, again, this is the view of the rear of the homes. On the west, you have the lot line setback, then you have the drainage easement, then you have a fence, and then you have the dog kennel further to the west. I do want to point out that the structure for the dog kennel is 145 feet from there, from their property line to our property line, which is a significant distance. Now, when we talk about compatibility of uses, generally, planners look at single family as the most compatible use to other uses. In other words, single family does not create a compatibility concern to other uses, and in fact, your land development code is written that way. So when you look at placing new uses next to existing uses, single family is the use that you don't require buffers for. There are no buffers required when you put single family next to multifamily, but there are buffers required when you put multifamily next to single family. The same is true on the west side of the development. We're putting single family next to what is zoned agricultural use, but is constructed as a dog kennel. If you were to put a dog kennel in, you would put a buffer in, but putting a single family use, you don't have to have a buffer. Why is this important? When you decrease the setback from 8 feet, which it currently is now, to 5 feet, that decrease is de minimis, especially when the use is 145 feet away. There is no compatibility concern. It just is not there. Going from 8 feet to 5 feet in the rear does not create a compatibility issue with residential to any adjacent use. I want to talk about the comprehensive plan for a moment. Your staff did a good job of discussing compatibility in their staff report. They found the proposed setbacks to be compatible with adjacent uses. They also did a discussion about compliance with the comprehensive plan. We agree with their analysis. First off, it's not easy, as you all know, to get affordable housing developments approved. There's a stigma attached to affordable housing. It's not easy to find sites where it's appropriate for affordable housing. And many of the sites that are in proximity to places where workers will work, so you decrease those commute distances, are oftentimes your most expensive land, and it makes it difficult to find sites for affordable housing. So when we find a site, it's incumbent on us to make the site work. And your comprehensive plan has a number of policies that both encourage the city of Bonita Springs to address the affordable housing issue within the city, but also have very direct policies that say, like objective 1.3, reduce by the end of the planning period the percentage of city households identified as being lower income and in need of housing assistance from 7.6 to 5%. If we're going to make strides in doing that, again, we need to take a look at the properties that we have where it makes sense for affordable housing and make sure they work. Just a couple final notes about compatibility. Again, this is a unique site. If this were a site surrounded on all sides by single family, it would obviously be a different discussion. It's not. It's a site surrounded by a dog kennel and a lift station where the setbacks are. If this were a site that had other uses that were generally seen by or attracted by the public, I could see the discussion being different. This is a fairly isolated site. It is a site that that you don't have compatibility concerns, and the setback that is being requested is de minimis in nature. At that, I'll turn it over to staff who has a presentation as well, or if you have any questions.
Council? Yes. Amy, yes.
Go back to the picture where you were showing us the driveways.
Yes.
Yeah, the microphone.
On the one in the lower right, where the silver truck is, would that be where the driveway of a house that's built with the reduced front setback be? Just conceptually? Because you're going to bring it forward, how many, 10 feet or something?
5 feet.
5 feet.
So essentially what this shows you is that with that 5 foot, if you move the house up 5 feet,
right,
you would still be able to park two cars in that
right,
driveway.
But here you could park three cars. So what happens is
that's right.
So instead of parking three cars where the rest of the neighborhood is, you're going to be parking two cars basically.
Two cars and then one in the garage.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Now, Fred?
Yeah, question. I've been told that this development is an HOA. Is it or isn't it? Which therefore means any of the drainage areas and all that are owned by everybody in the HOA. Okay, thank you.
Okay, Council, anything else?
Dan, what's the current front setback? You say it's going to 10. What is it? Yeah.
I believe it's 20 feet.
20 to 15.
Sorry.
Thanks.
Okay. Council, anything else?
So the 20 is, that doesn't include the drainage area that you're talking about?
It does not include the drainage area.
So the drainage area is what?
10 feet.
10 feet, so it's 30 feet from the drive, the paved pavement.
Yeah, to the garage.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Great, thank you.
Good morning. Mike Fegan, representing staff, community development. Just to sort of follow up on what the applicant was explaining, you know, we have the nature of the request, which let's keep in mind there are multiple requests in on this application. It's not just setbacks. There's also a lot coverage request as well, as Audrey pointed out. So we have setback requests for lots 10 and 11, which are on the west side of the project, going from a 20-foot front yard setback down to 15 feet. We also have a rear yard setback request on those two lots, going from 8 feet down to 5 feet. On the other side of the cul-de-sac, lots 16 and 17, we have a rear setback reduction request from 20 feet down to 5 feet. And then we also have a request the applicant has a request in to amend the lot coverage maximum for 3 out of those 4 lots. For lot 10 to 63%, to lot 11, to 66% for lot 10, 63% for lot 11, and 48% for lot 17. Right now, the standard is 40%, so it is a relatively significant lot coverage increase that they are requesting. This is a copy of the original master concept plan back when the project was zoned residential plan development, subject to a 2005 zoning ordinance. As you can see, you have the lot layout. You can see the lots that we're discussing, lots 10, 11, 16, and 17 here. We felt that this master concept plan lacked a little bit of detail. So one of the things that we had the applicant do with this request was revise the master concept plan to include additional details. Go ahead and putting the proposed building footprints right there on the master concept plan, and then also providing cross sections so we could review the drainage appropriately. You have the current development regulations in this zoning ordinance right here. You see your front, your side, your rear. They have two sets of rear setbacks already that tend to depend on which side of the development that you're on. 1 through 15 has one set of rear yard setbacks, and lots 16 through 26 has a separate set of rear yard setbacks. You also have your maximum building height and your maximum lot coverage. So the idea would be to go from this to something more like that. Everything that's underlined is what would be subsequent to this particular request should it be approved. And I think the thing to keep in mind in terms of the setbacks and for the lot coverages, we are only talking about these 4 lots in question. It's not a wholesale change for the entire development. So one of the things that we looked at was we looked at what was considered to be a standard lot within the subdivision in terms of width and depth compared to the 4 lots that are in question. And one of the things the staff examined was, are there discrepancies or areas are there substandard lots within this subdivision? And yes, everything that I have in red highlights a insufficiency within the project as a whole. So you have typical lots on the east side being 45 feet wide by 115 feet deep. And you can see that lots 16 and 17 have some issues in terms of meeting that typical nature. On the west side of the subdivision, you have the same problem. You have a typical lot as it's shown on the plat, 45 feet wide by 103 feet deep. And you can see in red where the discrepancies are with that. So there are some issues overall with these lots in terms of the size. So that is something that staff was able to establish. When we look at the examination of reducing the front setback from 20 feet down to 15 feet, yes, it is true that the driveway length would be shortened by 5 feet. Based on the code, it would still not cause a parking concern. Parking requirements for single-family homes is 2 spaces. The garage is allowed to serve as a space. The driveway can also serve as your spaces if you don't have a garage. These homes are being built with garages, so the 5-foot reduction does not inhibit the project to meet its parking requirement of having at least 2 spaces per home. And then also, as Mr. DeLisi had described, was the distance from the property line to the edge of pavement is also, there's additional driveway there of 10 plus feet where you could also use to park a car. The other thing to keep in mind is that the lots are on a cul-de-sac. So when you're on a cul-de-sac, because of the shape of the cul-de-sac, you sort of have this natural curve to the property line. And then also with your setbacks, you have this natural offset because you have the circle that convexes out. So by default, your homes are a little bit offset. Reducing the front setback by 5 feet aesthetically doesn't do much, in staff's opinion, it doesn't do much to damage the overall flow around that cul-de-sac. It also doesn't affect the drainage around that cul-de-sac because it's not being built into the easements. The easements are not going to be touched during this reduction. So that was one thing that we wanted to point out. So what I did was, poorly, I'm sorry to say that I wasn't able to get this too good for you. You have the black line, which is the property line. You can see how far away that is from the edge of pavement. And you have, I took the blue lines, and the blue lines would be the required setback. And I went ahead and adjusted them for the lots in question. So this is down to 15 feet, and this is down to 15 feet. And I dotted my line around it, and you can see there's still that natural curve coming around the cul-de-sac. And again, this was just to prove that aesthetically, a 5 foot difference wasn't going to cause too much issue when looking at it, either from the roadway, from above, from behind. The natural progression really wasn't being affected by 5 feet. We also looked at the drainage that would affect these lots in question and the project as a whole. And that was actually one of the things that we had the applicant go back and redo for us. When the initial application was submitted to staff, there wasn't much info in there about the drainage for the site. We requested that they go back and provide additional information about the drainage. We wanted to see where these building slabs would be in conjunction to the drainage and the slope that accommodates the drainage, and we wanted to know if that was going to be safe and if it was going to cause an undue impact externally for the dog kennel, the lift station, all those types of things. And what we saw was that there really weren't any issues in that regard, which I will get into in an additional second. You do have a swale on the east side that is 40 feet wide, and you have a swale on the west side that is 12 feet wide. It is important to note that these drainage areas are not located within the individual property boundaries of the individual lots. It's within the project boundary, but not the individual property boundaries. And the setbacks we're taking from the individual property boundaries. So in that regard, the size of the drainage, its function, its capacity is not being compromised with this particular request. You can see the cross sections down here. This is the 40-foot cross section for this one up here. And AA is this one here. And this is what we had them provide to us. We had them go over those cross sections, show us the slopes, show us where the building pad footprints would be. We had them reviewed by our engineering department for drainage compliance, and it was determined that there were going to be no drainage issues should council decide to go forward with approving this particular request. One other thing I wanted to point out was in general, there are allowances throughout the standard land development code for 5 foot setbacks in the rear. They tend to be more geared towards accessory structures, pools, decks, screen enclosures, things like that. You're still talking about putting a slab, putting some type of impact on the ground, but there is an allowance for that right now in the code. So for an example, if these homes were already built and they wanted to have a 5 foot setback for an additional slab for a deck, we'll say, that would be permitted right now by right. There would be no public hearing for that. It's an allowance that's built into the code already. So I just wanted to sort of throw that in there as an idea that should there be an approval for a 5 foot rear yard setback, we do have code-based language that could support that as well. The lot coverage request was the second portion of the overall request. 40% is the standard right now within the plan development. Largely it's the standard throughout the city, but plan developments are allowed to amend that. But within this particular plan development, within this ordinance that was passed in 2005, 40% was the standard. And what that is in terms of lot coverage, that is an under-roofed building requirement. So you can have so much square footage under roof before you exceed your lot coverage requirement. In this case, it's 40%. In order for Habitat to be able to fit their existing product that they have in the subdivision on these four lots, they would have needed to amended the lot coverage requirement for three out of those four lots to make it fit. So lot 10 is requesting 66%, lot 11 is requesting 63%, lot 17 is requesting 48%. The overall square footage of the product is 1,859 square feet. So in order to make that fit on those lots, the staff report gets into it in pretty good detail for you guys. That's what would be needed. Staff didn't seem to have, we didn't have an issue with that because it is the same product that they are proposing to be built. So while the lot coverage is increasing, making it seem like it's a bigger product, it's the same size house, but because the lot is substandard, it makes it seem like it's a little bit bigger than what it actually is. It's the exact same size house. And I sort of broke it down here for you in terms of what the 40% would be versus what's there. For lot 10, 40% would get them a little over 1,400 square feet. They need 1,859. For lot 11, it'd get them up to 1,500. Again, they need 1,859. Lot 16 is fine. That's the only lot of these four that doesn't have a lot coverage issue. And lot 17, the 40% would get them up to 1,700. Again, they need 1,859. To build a compatible product. The other thing that we looked at would be with this lot coverage, does it have an effect on the overall open space requirement? And yes, it does have an effect on the overall open space requirement, but it does not have an effect to the point that it drops below the required thresholds, either of Lee County at the time during the original development order or for the city of Bonita Springs. We would require that at least 40% of the entire project be dedicated to open space. Right now, with this request, should it be approved, they would still have 66%. So they are exceeding their open space requirement even with this request. So because of all those areas, staff did feel that it was okay to provide a recommendation of approval for these specific requests. There are some conditions that staff did put in place, and staff stands by them very strongly. The first one being these changes are for these four lots in question only. It is not a wholesale change to the entire development. We're talking lots 10, 11, 16, and 17 only. A second condition would be that no encroachments can go into that 5-foot rear yard setback, including additional decking, AC pads, landings, whatever. We do not want anything to go into that 5-foot rear yard setback. The reason why is because if I go back to the cross section that was provided, this would be the edge of my building pad into my slope that provides my drainage. Staff did have a safety concern if there was to be access, mechanical equipment, an additional pad into that, that drainage could be compromised and there could be a safety concern again if there was access there. So staff did have an additional condition built into that, tying into our third condition, which is that if you have a screen enclosure, the access to the screen enclosure should be on the side and not the rear for just that purpose. We don't want it into the slope. We don't want an additional pad into the slope. We don't want anything affecting the slope that could affect the drainage. So any access to a screen enclosure, for an example, would have to come off of the side of the home and not the rear. The same would go for mechanical equipment. We don't want to see any encroachments into this 5-foot rear yard setback for any of these lots. And then, of course, additional amendments would require additional approval. So we try to keep it very narrowly scoped to what we would approve with this request, the setbacks, the lot coverage, and that's where we are. Also attached is a copy of the new master concept plan that we had them submit with the additional detail. You can see they included the cross sections here. They included the building footprints. They also included the moving of the AC pads to the sides. And again, there's a condition built in as well not to encroach into that 5-foot side yard setback as well, including the AC pads and the equipment itself. So all of that was addressed in the staff report and on your conditions of approval found in your staff report and in the draft ordinance that Audrey has. If you have any questions or comments of me or the applicant, we'd be happy to answer them for you.
Okay, let me start down at this end. Fred?
Yeah, I am troubled by that 5 foot. And first of all, the families that live there will tend to have a good amount of children. So there's no way that that common area isn't going to be the backyard, the real backyard for these homes. And I'm troubled by that. I really am. I don't think it's right. I don't think increasing the density like is being proposed is right. And you know what? They bought this thing the way it was, and they ought to use it that way. Make it successful. And I disagree with two-story as wrong, because you've already made a big point that it's not residential single family, and it's not up against. You can do what you want. You can put a two-story in there. So that's what I think. Thank you.
Mike?
From what I see, I'm actually fine with it, being as we do have that additional 12-foot in drainage and 40-foot on the other side. The 12-foot plus the 5 that they're going to have setback is 17 feet. And I had John Dolmer pull up this morning. If you go right around the corner to Nikki J. Court on their cul-de-sac, those houses are actually 15 feet to the property line. So that's 2 feet less than what they're actually going to have here. And the auxiliary structure is only 10 feet to the property line. So, I mean, compatibility in that area, just right around the corner, you have houses that are closer to the property line. So,
okay. Great. Thanks. Peter?
Yeah. I'm inclined to be supportive, but I do have some questions. What's the reason for a side set, a rear setback?
In the code? Original?
No, in the code. What's the reason for a rear setback?
To create distance between you and your adjacent property owner, and also to serve additional ancillary functions to utilities, drainage, so on and so forth. That's my understanding of its purpose.
Okay, so Dan was talking about that in terms of compatibility and such, but there's no other independent reason for it in terms of space behind a house?
For a backyard area?
Yeah, a separate value that's in the code, or is it just a concern about nearby neighbors? John, you want to take a shot?
Morning, Councilman.
Hey.
To my understanding, unless there is a section hidden in a deep, dark corner that I have not seen, the whole purpose of those setbacks is to address the scale and massing and provide that consistency and compatibility. It works hand in hand with other sections of the code that talk about consistency and compatibility of uses. So that way, when you look at whatever could go behind this particular use, you're looking at having it consistent and compatible as defined not only by the setback but also by those uses that could go adjacent to the property. In this particular case, it's a little bit different in the fact that the property lines are not the project lines.
Right. What is the typical in a standard zoning rear setback?
It's 15, 20 feet.
15, 20 feet.
It depends on the district. If you're looking, there are some that go up as high as 25, but you also see them in plan developments that go down as low as 5.
Well, plan developments, right.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, John.
Steve?
I'm good with it.
Okay. Greg?
I'm good with it. I think it's time to put it bluntly, put our money where our mouth is. We keep talking about affordable housing and stuff like that. This is one way I think that we can support it without putting any money into it or without doing any types of subsidies or anything like that, just allowing the zoning. I'm with Mike. I don't think it's that big of a deal. I see where Fred's coming from on it, but I think it's time we sit here and tout every once in a while about how we want to have some affordable housing and get workforce housing in here. I've been to the ribbon cuttings in this development, and I think they're doing a fine job out there. It is in my district. Well,
go ahead.
It's close. I hear all the feedback from it more so than
it's in
you.
Mine too.
Yeah, it's in yours too. So it's close enough in my district where I hear some of the feedback on it, and I haven't heard very much, if any, negative. Like I said, to the west is or to the east side is BSU, and I'm sure they're fine with it. And the dog kennel, like I said, it's 140 feet to the actual structure of the dog kennel.
Right.
And it's just a wooded area, and surrounded by a fence, so I'm good with it.
Amy?
Yeah, I just have a couple of problems with lot number 10, you know, because, I mean, lot number 11, again, because of where that driveway's coming in there. And, you know, I think that these are difficult areas to build on, And I see that you have the, you know, the, I think that, that driveway, I think, is going to be an issue, but I guess if the people don't care. And the other problem I have is this drawing on the that you have on the bottom of this plot that you showed us, you know, where you show the, sure, the drainage. Is that a building problem to have the building right where it slopes down? Because isn't that how the drainage is supposed to, if you have to use the drainage, wouldn't that fill up? I mean, how does that work?
So we had our engineers take a look at that for mm-hmm. just that reason. Mm-hmm. We had them examine it versus building code, OSHA standards, what have you, to determine whether or not a slab on the slope like that would have a negative effect on the drainage.
Mm-hmm.
The feedback that I received was that there wasn't anything to show in our code, OSHA standards, building code, to demonstrate that that would not be an acceptable engineering practice in that regard. Where it does become problematic is if you have ingress or egress coming off of that slope because of the drop between, I'll go and go back for a second, the drop that you have from slab to grade right away is a foot. And if you have more than 7 inches per building code, you have to provide an additional landing or a pad. An additional landing or a pad into that slope on that 3-to-1 is where we would start to see concerns with the drainage. And then because of that, you know, having the safety issue of, as well, having the pad providing access into the slope. So that's where we saw the biggest concern.
Well, that's my question. When that diagram, that's actually where the building is. Is there a door out there? How do people get out of their house?
There isn't right now.
No. And mm-hmm. there would not be a door there?
Well, in our conditions, we said if you're going to have access, you're not going to do it off of the rear into the slope. It would have to be on the side of the home.
All right. And so then there would just be like grass there or something?
Right now, these homes are built without screen enclosures. It's
right.
sort of, it's a deck area that's under roof,
right.
but there's no real screen enclosure.
So they would screen that open area?
You walk out of your house
right.
onto an existing slab that's
right.
already under roof, not into the
mm-hmm.
sloped area, onto that building mm-hmm. pad. From there is where you would have your slope beyond that. What we were suggesting is that if you do intend to provide screen enclosures and
mm-hmm.
enclose
mm-hmm.
it, that you do not provide access mm-hmm. into the rear for that safety reason.
Okay. And then now, if we had water in there, I mean, this provides a certain amount of water. Where would the water, how far up would it go? I mean, I don't know anything about drainage.
We don't have one of our engineers here.
Does anybody know anything about drainage?
Everybody's looking at everybody else.
I mean, is it... Why is it 3
Come
and
on,
a half?
Audrey.
I don't know what the depth is there, but I mean, why do we have whatever that depression is? It must provide for some sort of water, and in what circumstances would you use it?
So the community as a whole is designed to contain its water, and then for the water to either dissipate or to actually drain out to into a larger system. The 3-to-1 that you're looking at is the slope from the house. That slope is the max, as it says there's a max. That slope can actually be held down on the back of the home. And so working with staff, we agreed that there would be no access coming off the rear of the home. And because of the way the homes are designed, they have a open lanai right now, covered area, that is just as easy for our homeowners to step off to the side yard and to address some of the other concerns as far as the space in those yards. If you take a look at each one of those yards separately, those instead of having a rear space for activities in the rear, they actually have these lots are pie shaped, so you actually have yard to the side that is usable. And so, to answer your question, any screen lanai that had a door would actually come off to the side yard where there is actually more opportunity to have activity.
Okay, now if you look on 17 and this little depression picture, is that for lots 17 and 16? What, or is that for both sides?
It would just be for the east and west side, depending on their drainage easement. So that long one there where the 40-foot common open space and drainage easement, that's along the east side.
Mm-hmm.
And on the other one would be
right.
for the west side.
Okay, so now I have to ask my question again. The reason why it has this depression in it is because that's where the drainage from the property, it's all the property is supposed to go along there. Okay?
Correct. That's where it collects
right.
in those
and when
drainage
one
swales.
Designs that, I assume there's a certain volume of water that's assumed to be used for, right? Would it just be in the lower part of it, or would it come up that slope when you drain the water? How does that work? I'm concerned that this building is right there where the water might come up to the back of the building. Would that happen?
The swale, the setback is not affecting the swale. So I think what you're asking is the swale designed so that it fills up and then the water overtops the banks and then gets to the home?
Excuse me just a second. Can we keep the side conversations to a minimum, please?
We have
Thank
a building
you.
Here, and I assume... Let me explain it. We have a building here, okay? This is where the house is, all right? Then we have this well, all right? And I assume water is going to be in here, all right? And my question is, there's a volume of water this is designed for, correct? Is it going to come up here?
No.
Is it going to come up here?
Yes.
All right, so this building will not be impacted. I'm worried about this building.
Yeah.
All right. That's what I want to know.
Okay, so let me try and explain that. And I apologize for it taking so long to get there. The 40-foot common open space and drainage easement, that's where the 3-foot dimension starts. That is being designed in accordance with a water management permit to contain all of the water that is being discharged into it and then sent off-site. And so the 5-foot area is a slope just to get water off of the lot into that. That's not part of the swale itself. The swale starts 5 feet back from the building.
This is okay. Dry.
Yes, that's right. So you see the back of the building starts
with... But that's not what's shown in the diagram. It's what's shown on the thing on the top. I mean, the...
Yeah, I think what Dan is saying is that this 5 feet right here...
Where is that?
That's the setback to the lot line.
And this is not part of the swale.
Yes.
This is what brings water
so
off...
So the diagram is incorrect, is
no,
what you're telling me.
No, it is correct.
Where's the 5 feet?
The building slab is that here.
Right here? So,
right.
So you sort of go down like
so
that.
So that's
and
not
then
part
this,
of the swale?
This starts the swale here.
It looks like the swale to me.
According to the water management permit uh-huh. that's existing from the 2060.
Now I get it. Again, this 5 feet, is this 5 feet?
Yes.
And this 5 feet is here?
That's 3 feet.
That's 3 feet, yes.
That's 3 feet.
Yes.
So you're saying the swale is 3 feet?
The edge of the swale, the bank of the swale is 3 feet.
But it would be sloped from the building down to that?
In order to drain the lot itself, yes.
So if that is designed properly, the water shouldn't go more than up until the 3-foot area. The 5 feet would be okay, then the 3 feet would come in unless they designed it improperly.
That's correct.
Okay, so so that building should not be intruded on by the water.
That's right.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions, counsel?
Yeah, I have a legal question. And once again, in the context, I'm inclined to support this. There are many of us who are financial contributors to Habitat. We put our money where our mouth is. But this is a zoning issue before the city. So I'm assuming that is not a reason to distinguish this and approve it, that I support charity or isn't.
As far as it being part of your charitable donations, I do not see a voting conflict.
I'm not asking that. Yeah.
If it,
Let me try. Part of my concern is the next applicant, the one we don't have here.
Right.
All right. And how do we distinguish this if we approve it uh-huh. from that, when that person comes in and says, you just approved this here and that. And there are reasons I think that Dan gave on compatibility to help with respect to that. But I'm assuming that for those of us who are inclined to vote for it, it shouldn't be to distinguish it on the basis of this was Habitat for Humanity, we were trying to help them out, as opposed to the next developer.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
That would be too much of a disparate impact. I think you've
Thank
heard
you.
te- May I just finish?
Oh, sorry.
You heard testimony from your planners as well as one of the council members about Nikki J. Court, that this is not atypical in a development.
Thanks, Audrey.
You know, thanks, Peter. And I'm going to jump in here. That's what I shared with Neil Montgomery. That's what I shared with Don Thompson. Fabulous reputation, fabulous organization, outstanding reputation. But my concerns are we doing it? Would we do it if it was just XYZ citizen coming down the road? Or are we blinded by the fact that it's Habitat for Humanity? And are we setting a bad precedent moving forward?
But the issue is you have done it for other John citizens. And I think that's where Mr. Fegan can provide additional testimony that makes council more comfortable. Council has heard me say many times, you never approve a case because it is John Smith, because John Smith can get rid of it next week.
Right.
So with that, Mr. Fegan?
We have other planned developments just like this, an RPD, residential plan development. There are other planned developments within the city that have been approved by city council vote for either an equal setback or even less restrictive than this. There are projects within the city that actually have a 0-foot setback to the property line that were approved. So if the issue is whether or not this would be looked at as doing a favor for Habitat, there are other cases where evidence has been put forward that it did make sense to go ahead and give a less restrictive setback in the past.
And let me ask a question, probably neither here nor there. But say this does go through and this is granted, and they have a water problem there, they have a flooding problem there, they have a drainage problem there. Who's on the hook?
They would be on the hook. One of the things that we had them do as staff was demonstrate that this would not affect their existing water management permit that they have with FDEP. They were able to provide us a waiver saying that these setbacks would not affect the existing water management permit, and that they did not need to redo, redesign, or anything like that for water management on site. So we did have them do that. The copy of the waiver letter should be in your packet.
Yeah, and the insurance company, let's just go forward to a claim, a full-blown claim. How are they going to look at this?
At this point, and let's just, in fact, I'll go back to the last question and concern that several of you had. This application received a recommendation for approval, not because of the applicant, but because what they proposed functioned and it met standards as we require and the Water Management District require. When water management systems are designed in Bonita Springs, they are designed to accommodate 1 inch of gross area on site. The city of Bonita Springs requires an additional 50% of that area to be added for water quality, not for quantity, but for quality. And so when we're looking at how these sites function, we require more than the water management district requires. And in terms of how it's designed and who's on the hook, if it's designed to their standards and certified that it was constructed to their standards, it's the water management district permit that is in play at that point if there is a concern. If there is a flooding issue, several things are considered. One is the severity of the event, and two, how is the site constructed? Was it functioning? Was it maintained? There's a lot of things that go into a potential claim that some are and some are not zoning issues. So what we're looking at today is a system that functions. It's been designed to the standards that not only the city of Bonita Springs maintains, but also those standards that the Water Management District maintains. And that's why you were receiving approval for this. I don't want to go too much into insurance questions, mainly because I'm not in the insurance industry, and I would do probably more damage than good answering those questions on how a claim is processed. But in terms of a zoning question, that's why you received this recommendation, and that's why you saw in your recommendations the conditions as they are proposed, because we are looking to minimize any of those negative impacts, and we are trying to make sure that the site continues to function.
Sorry. Fred?
Yeah, I want to make sure one thing. The 1.5 inch, that's you're saying this pond, this retention area, was designed to that standard?
I've been corrected by our engineers. It is not 1.5 inches. It is 1 inch plus an additional 50%. And it is my understanding that, yes, it has been. Now, this was done This was originally permitted prior to the city assuming its own.
That's why I'm asking the question.
That's a very good point. And I know that if it, we could take, how about I take a look at that and get back with you on it? Because I don't want to give you an answer that's incorrect.
Okay, that's now, I'm fine with front driveway. I can handle the 5 foot between side and property line. The reason that you have decent setbacks, especially where you have a lot of kids and a family, is for a yard. I mean, you can say it's property line and the project boundary line. Okay, the point that Amy was bringing up is excellent, and I hope we'd never have approved something where it's, you're going out on a slope when you step out the back of the house, if you stepped out the back of the house. I imagine those 5 foot yards are not where you have that situation. But if we ever did, we should never do it again. That's what I think.
Council, Peter?
Yeah, Dan, I wonder if you could give me a little help on distinguishing from the next case. So when you're in, hopefully you represent the next applicant, so you're not in here saying, hey, you did it for me 2 weeks ago. What makes this different?
Well, look, as a planner, when we look at these things, we always look at compatibility and surrounding uses. I don't think you're going to find another case where the uses are either set back as far as they're set back, or it's isolated. I mean, we are right next to a lift station. On both sides, north and south, for multifamily development. It's, if this were in a situation where you have single family on all four sides or on one side even, then it would be a totally different discussion. And I don't think you would be able to use precedent in that situation. But you are unique in the location itself. Location drives everything in real estate. And in land use planning, and location is the key in this case.
Thank you.
Council?
Make a motion to approve. Oh, we need a public comment.
Yeah, and I was gonna say, before we move forward here, we're gonna do public, let's do public input, excuse me, at this time.
Okay, Rick Steinmeier, do I get swearing in or something? I did. Okay. it's not on the program here, but lot 9 and 18, if you look at this picture on page 6, shows that their setback in their backyard is smaller than the one on the lots next to them. I hope they got approval for that in the first place. The 5 foot setbacks, front back, I mean, on the side and the back. I'm glad to see you're not allowed to put anything out there, because I have many places in town where people have put their, have encroached in on that 5 foot setback. It's been a bad mistake. I think I hope this corrects it. but there's not much room for the kids, you know, to run in the backyard. You're not allowed to put anything back there. So. It's pretty tight. I guess they're affordable. $200,000 is affordable nowadays, but I'd approve this. But on the other aspect, this area is cul-de-sac area. It looks like it's pretty big. Could that be made into a neighborhood park? Something like that gives some extra space for the kids to play in. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick. Other members of the public, please come forward at this time. Councilman Alex Grant, good morning.
Yes, I'm the neighbor to the south. South.
There's a problem here that I addressed.
Alex, maybe we can get you the microphone. Thank you.
That left not a question.
Where lot 12 is,
not in question.
There's a monument here that was put by my family, Amy Engineering, 1973, August 1973. We had, it's this section surveyed, okay? We were the first people that surveyed it. The monument is here. The fence is on, somebody put a fence on our side of the monument recently. When they put the water well here.
Yes, sir.
And we've had, so on lot 12, where lot 12 is, the monument is here on this side, the fence is on this side. You follow me? They put the fence on my side. That's number one. Number two, we've had trash here from construction, et cetera. I don't know, there is, should be the homeowner association taking care of that. And also, I'd like to have permission from the homeowner association if I ever need to have the surveyor come on the property number 12, that the surveyor has the permission to use that monument that's on my property, not on their property.
Alex, thank you for your comments. Audrey, this is a bit of a unique situation, especially for me sitting in this chair, but I think the time is absolutely germane to address this. How do you recommend we address this?
As far as potential encroachment, I was looking at Ms. Green, whether or not they had even placed the fence there. And my understanding is not their fence. It appears that there might be an encroachment. I have not looked at the legal, but it's not a zoning issue. So, and I understand. And this is something that probably Mr. Grant needs to deal with. Whoever fence it is, because if it's not their fence, as far as permission for a surveyor to enter, state law allows surveyors to go on private property, so that's not an issue whatsoever. And if there's trash issues, again, that's an enforcement, that's not a zoning issue, but I'm sure the applicant will work with them on any trash issues, I would hope.
Yes, we'll be happy to work with you. We've never put a fence in, so if there's an issue, it's whoever put the fence in, but we're happy to work with you on any issues. Just give me a call.
When did this fence appear?
This fence appeared after BSU put the well in. Across, so, that would be over here.
Okay. All right, Alex. And Audrey,
we will
work through that with BSU. Thank you, Alex. Other members of the public, please come forward at this time. Good morning. Alex, we'll get that worked through. Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Appreciate the time. My name is Darren Robertshaw. Been in Bonita Springs for about 20 years. I am Chief Operating Officer of the Trianon Hotel Company. I'd like to ask you to support this, support Habitat and Humanity, support anything we can do for workforce housing. We struggle to get employees in our businesses. It makes it hard for me as an operator to want to expand my business out of fear of not being able to staff it. So I have roughly 60 employees, approximately 5 live in Bonita Springs. All of them live in Lehigh, Cape Coral, North Fort Myers, or South Fort Myers. They commute. The commutes are getting longer, and it's a real struggle. So I appreciate any support you guys can do. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Other members of the public? Yes, please, come on, come right up.
Thank you, and you've been sworn in.
Yes. Hi, good morning, Naomi Miranda.
Good morning.
I am a homeowner there at Red Blossom.
Thank you.
I'm kind of stuck in the middle because I understand both sides, the numbers, you know, everything. Fred did mention about the backyard, and yes, I'm a parent of two. I have a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old. Reality, I don't spend that much time in the backyard because it's not fenced in. My children have, I have one that has special needs, so I tend to keep them inside, but I can't speak for all the parents there. Yes, you do want to do a cookout. I just had one last night. I'm sure a lot of people did because it was Easter. And yes, I wanted to prove because I want someone to be able to have a home there, just like I did. Yes, there are issues that are going to be brought up maybe in the future, you know. Can I do this? Can I not do that? And I think we're all kind of stuck. Well, is it because it's habitat? Well, we're making a storm in a glass of water. It's zoning. It's a house. I do approve it. I want it to be approved. I do want someone to have a home, and I'm trying to understand both sides. And I'm kind of like I said, in the middle. But I do want to give someone else that opportunity to have a home there, as well as I did. So I really do hope that we do figure out what needs to, or the compromise. And I mean, I hope so far what I'm hearing, it's okay. But I do want it to be approved, as long as everything is met in the right area and everything is compromised from both sides. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Other members of the public at this time?
Have you been sworn in?
Good morning.
How you doing? Jesus Abrego. I live Red Blossom also. And I think it's good that we'll be able to get another person to live in there. If they ain't got room to play in their yard, they can come to my yard. It ain't a problem. I got 5 kids. So if we don't have room sometimes, we go across. There's a field right there. So if they want to go play, they can go across the road too. That's where we go. We go play football, soccer, wherever. So I think it's good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you. Other members of the public? Okay, seeing none. Oh, sorry. There you go.
My name's Tom Lambert, and I'm a resident of Bonita Springs and live in the community of Bonita Bay. 17 years ago, when I retired, I was looking for something to get involved with, and I picked Habitat for a couple reasons. One, all the good things they do, and you've heard that, so I won't reiterate. It does tremendous, a lot of good for a lot of people. Keeps a lot of people out of the welfare rolls. It helps them elevate in their kids and their next generation of kids have a very good probability of being strong citizens of Bonita Springs and our country. The other reason is I like to build. I like to pound nails. but anyway, I want to tell you a little story about 08, 09, when land got very expensive in Bonita Springs. Habitat was building at the rate of 5-6 homes a year, and we ran out of land. The dollars raised in Bonita Springs wound up going to Lehigh Acres, Cape Coral, and other locations. So there's probably at least 10 units of affordable housing lost to Bonita Springs because we couldn't find land. We're headed down that same path. Land is getting more expensive. It's getting more scarce. A couple years, we're going to run out. And effectively, these 4 units of land, if we lose them, that money will eventually go somewhere else. And those 4 units of affordable housing will go somewhere else. In addition to becoming a mail pounder, and I've been building these homes for 16 years, I was also on the front end of the fundraiser in Bonita Bay. The residents of Bonita Bay started a fundraiser, and they raised enough money to build approximately 35 homes in Bonita Springs. And when we started that, our objective was to build homes in Bonita Springs, to work on the affordable housing issue in Bonita Springs. Our intent was not for that money to go elsewhere. That's still the intent. We'd like to continue to contribute money and have those homes. So the issue here is not so much helping Habitat. The issue is helping families in need of affordable housing and helping Bonita Springs, who has a significant need for affordable housing. On an additional issue, the Bonita Springs Affordable Housing Corporation used to be a facilitator of affordable housing. They went out of business. So really, to best of my knowledge, your only facilitator of affordable housing, which is a significant need, is Habitat for Humanity. So I would encourage council to support Habitat as much as you can, and really maybe get some special effort to do something more to help us find land. Because land, I've toured. Matter of fact, Alex Grant took me on a tour 8 years ago, and we didn't find much. And that hasn't improved, by the way, in 8 years. So I ask you to support this, and thank you for your time.
Thank you. Other members of the public? You don't need to wait till I move on. You can. Okay, just wanted to double check. Okay, was there any... I heard Peter was getting ready to make a motion. Is there any other communication, Audrey, from a staff point of view at this time?
I need disclosure of your ex parte communication.
And I was going to mention that, okay, but I just want to make sure. Is there anybody that had any ex parte communications that they want to disclose? Fred, we'll start with you.
Mike, my things were on file.
Okay, Mike?
I spoke with Don Thompson, right?
Yeah. I had Dave Eckrich and Don Thompson.
Right. Myself, Don Thompson.
Nobody.
Neil Montgomery on the way in the door. I'm sorry, Greg?
Nothing.
Amy? No? Okay. Okay. Is there a...
I make a motion to approve.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second to approve with, obviously, the conditions. And I feel duty-bound to go over those conditions again, sure. Just so everybody's crystal clear.
Sure. One, two, three.
Conditions.
Can you pop it up on the screen too, please?
Sure. I think it's going to be. I don't know if I put it in the presentation. All of them.
Oh, okay. My mistake. I thought you had.
In your packet, they should be page 4 of mm-hmm. your packet.
Page 2 is where.
Well, page 2 of 6 of the ordinance with page 4 of the.
Oh, okay.
So condition 1, understanding that this is just for the lots in question, 10, 11, 16, and 17. So condition 1 would amend 2B of the zoning ordinance, which is the setback and lot coverage requirements, for a front setback of 15 feet for lots 10 and 11, a rear setback of 5 feet for lots 10 and 11, and a rear setback of 5 feet for lots 16 and 17. Building height stays the same. Maximum lot coverage gets adjusted for, again, just the lots in question. Lot 10, 66%. Lot 11, 63%. Lot 17, 48%. And 40% for all of the remaining lots, which was what the original lot coverage requirement was. Condition 2, there are no encroachments permitted into the 5-foot rear yard setback. This includes any additional decking, pads, landings, mechanical equipment, enclosures, or any other structure or appurtenance that is classified as a principal or accessory structure without obtaining additional amendments or deviations from the City of Bonita Springs. Condition 3 would be any screen enclosures constructed with doors and the pad landing on the side of the lot or any of the mechanical equipment or pads may not encroach into the required 5-foot side yard setback as well. Condition 4, any amendments will require additional approvals. And condition 5, all other conditions of the original zoning ordinance remain in full effect.
Great. Thank you.
And then just as a reminder, I will send a letter to BSU's special counsel regarding the concerns that Mr. Grant brought forward as to his easement, as to possibly an encroachment with a fence.
Great. Thank you. Fred?
Clarification. On the ones with a 5-foot backyard and you can't put any mechanical equipment there, then we're saying we can't encroach into the 5-foot side yard setback. Is that a problem on the houses with the 5-foot backyard?
I don't believe so. They could probably speak to that better than I can. But on the master concept plan that was provided for you, They went ahead and put in where the pads would be.
Okay.
And because the lots are a little bit more pie-shaped, you do tend to have more room on the one side.
That's what I was assuming.
Great.
I just have one question about the enclosed area, and you showed an elevation from the building down to the 5-foot setback. Can they just step off of that? Can they put steps there, or what happens there?
If there's, I don't know if maybe you can, I know that if there's meant to be access, you're supposed to provide a landing if your step down is more than 7 inches.
I know, but I think you showed on one of the was it a foot or from the building?
Oh, you.
You said that it was a foot above, the elevation was a foot or something?
At this point, right, we're not permitting anything that comes off of the back of those buildings. If something were to come in, it would need to be proposed and evaluated.
Well, this is my question, though, because the diagram shows that open area, and if they're elevated a foot or whatever you said, what is it, a foot?
It is, in fact.
So, over 5 feet. Is that a problem, is the question?
No.
They can just step off of that and go down the back?
At this point, if it's all open across that back patio area, yes, that is permissible. If they're going to restrict access, I say restrict access, if they're going to screen in that back porch, the access would need to be off the side of the building.
But that wouldn't be dangerous for someone to just jump off the, what is a foot? I don't know. That seems a little high to me. And we're restricting the fact that they couldn't put like a step there or something.
We are not permitting it at this point. And I realize that sounds like splitting hairs,
right,
but if someone wants to propose something, we'd evaluate what's being proposed at the time, because we're walking the balancing act of at what point do you stop restricting somebody's single family house and how their house functions versus how do we eliminate obvious problems.
Yeah,
and so
I would just, well, you could landscape that back end, couldn't you? That would make sense to me to do that so that we don't create another problem, because I don't want to have anybody come say, let me put a step here after we did this.
And that's why I'm phrasing this the way I am, because if somebody wants to come in and they want to do something, we're not saying that it's impossible, but we would want to make sure that whatever they propose, one, is safe, and two, does not impact or impede that water management system.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And why do we make it not impossible is my other question. We say you could come in and put something on the back thing. Is that not allowed?
Well, right now, the water management system is designed to simply convey water across that 5 feet of the back property line into the swale. If you want to put something in there, if you want to modify how that system works, I'm not saying that you can't propose
so
a solution
would have
that
to
functions.
Do a total rework, not just put a step in there or something. Yeah.
Depending on
I
the extent of their improvement, yes, ma'am.
Well, you want to be sensible.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know why, but no, it's a good motivation. Okay, but I would encourage the builder to maybe put some landscaping there, so I don't want you to come back and say they're falling off the back of their patio or whatever it is, you know, just so that visually at least there would be some obstruction there. I would feel more comfortable there.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Council, anything further?
I'm probably going to support this. But I think council needs to do two things. We need to fix it so this kind of stuff can't happen again. But we also need to see what we can do to help find a way to help Habitat and similar organizations to get affordable lots. But this is really, I don't think is right, but I'll go along with it.
Okay. Council, anything further? Roll call, please.
Councilman DeWitt.
Aye.
Councilman Slakta.
Aye.
Mayor Simmons.
Aye.
Councilman Forbes.
Aye.
Councilman
Forbes.
Gibson.
Sorry, Fred.
Oakland.
Aye. Uncle Fred.
Councilman Forbes.
Yes.
And Councilwoman Carumba.
Aye. Did we get Gibson?
We're all Gibby.
Councilman Gibson.
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Peter, you had said you wanted to make a...
Yeah, I just want to make a point aside from this, which is a process point. So for those of us who were in favor of this, which I was, this is a delightful presentation. But I do believe we need more balance in our staff presentation. Nothing to do with this case, but as an example. So we had a zoning board that met, I guess, for 2 hours, and they voted against it. And they had reasonable positions. And I do think what staff owes to council is, yes, to present a view as an expert. But I do think council, as well as the zoning board, is owed on any zoning issue, both sides on a reasonable basis, assuming there are both sides. So, you know, for here we heard a rationale that, well, you know, you have 5 feet. Well, but that was for accessory uses. That's not the primary setback. And there was nothing in staff's presentation that talked about what the standard is, which is much, the normal standard is, which is much more than that. So I just make a plea for us as decision makers that you put people up here in a position where they have the facts on both sides. As I say, in this case, I'm thrilled because all the facts are where I wanted to go. But I don't think that's what this process should just be about. It's my comment.
And thank you, Peter. And I'd go a step further. I know in the past, and I would hate to ever suggest, but look, if you're going to steer somebody, you're going to mention what zoning had done, right? I've heard that in the past. I didn't hear anything about zoning today. So I just want to add that.
Yeah, that's my fault for not putting it in the presentation. There is a section in your staff report that did go over what happened at the zoning board.
No, and I'm not trying to, you know, split hairs here, but maybe I am. We have a zoning committee, and I guarantee we've heard what their recommendation's been in the past. Right. And today, not even a whisper. Fred?
Yeah, and echoing on what Councilman O'Flynn said, I had thrown at us dozens of times today that we've done this in the past. So if we have, I would like to have had in that, we did it at this location where we put a house right up at the edge of a drainage swale, which then the swale dropped off into a pond. I'd really have trouble believing we did, but if we did, and I certainly, if this is a precedent, we're gonna have to change it by ordinance, so you can't call it a precedence anymore.
Okay, now approval of minutes, I believe, right, from our last meeting. Do we wanna do that?
Yep.
Motion to approve? So is there a second?
Second.
Okay, roll call, please.
Aye.
Councilman Slakta?
Aye.
Mayor Simmons?
Aye.
Councilman O'Flynn?
Aye.
Councilman Gibson?
Aye.
Councilman Forbes?
Aye.
Councilwoman Karamba?
Aye.
Councilman DeWitt?
Aye.
Councilman Slakta?
Anything else for the good of the order? We are adjourned. Thank you.
We're adjourned.